cover further in volatility. I mean, not some, just one topic was left using cyber triage tool. And you know, that topic won't be able to cover because my system is not up and I'm using Linux system now. Okay. Previously also it was Linux, but it's now different. Okay. So what, I mean, it's not something that I'm going to skip that topic, but what I recalled is the topic that we are going to cover today, that is use of cyber triage for memory analysis. Okay. Now that topic I have, you can say the same topic I was supposed to be, given as a presentation in VolCon International Conference. Okay. So luckily on VolCon's YouTube channel, I found the recording. It's this one. Okay. So what you could do is, I'll just give you the timestamps also. Okay. Yeah. The timestamps are not mentioned exactly. Okay. So the topic that was there for today's class, already luckily I have a conference recording of it directly. Cyber triage. It's me only. Okay. I'll share you the timestamp. I'll share you the YouTube link. Okay. I mean, I won't be, wasting some things over here to configure my system again and, wait till the system is up and running. The Windows system is up and running once again. Right. So I'll be sharing you this particular recording over here. And you are supposed to watch it. Simple as that. So it's an official, it starts from somewhere from 317 and up till the over here. It's kind of a 30-40 minute recording on cyber triage itself, the tool that we were going to use for memory analysis. Okay. The entire same thing as it is there in the course syllabus, the same thing is there in the conference or talk that I have given. Okay. So I'll be sharing you this recording on the group, the WhatsApp group, along with the timestamp. Okay. So what we will do is, we will as of now start with OSINT. Okay. And trust me, OSINT will be the big part and the most interesting part in the entire course, right? So the maximum of the practicals that are comprised in the course, maximum of the practicals as you saw till now, OSINT will be the one acquiring the major area for the practicals. Okay. Because in terms of investigation, OSINT is something which, private investigators love to do. I mean, that's the biggest area where private investigators can work upon. Right? It's the biggest weapon for PI. Other things you can say are restrictive power, power authorities and all those other things do play a role, legalities and all. But OSINT is something which is the biggest weapon of a PI. Okay? So basically, starting off with OSINT, let me just open a document. We have this initial class on today, OSINT, and we'll start about a web OSINT. All the upcoming further classes that you can expect will be on OSINT. Okay. And a lot of things we're going to do on OSINT. I mean, a lot of things we're going to do on OSINT. As I said, the maximum of the practical that is comprised in the entire course is of OSINT only. Considering the fact that the course is for investigation and not forensics, so OSINT plays a major role. And number two, I believe you will enjoy the OSINT, module. It will be the most favorite module in the entire class. Not only because it has practicals, but number two, I will be sharing a lot of insights about OSINT, and the various tools we are going to use. And why I am so excited about OSINT, I mean, just as a sharing perspective, I'm sharing you. Like the day I entered in cybersecurity till today, one of my major area where I've been working is OSINT only. Even if I was working with law enforcement agencies, you can say in 2019 for Maharashtra Cyber, I was working for OSINT. I'm working with a PI company, my maximum of the cases land up to OSINT. I'm working for different NGOs, my maximum of the work land into OSINT, right? Right. So OSINT is one of my, in fact, my own favorite topic, not one, but also, right. Now, I started off with OSINT. So OSINT is nothing but open source intelligence technique. Okay. If I just talk about in general layman terms, you know, reading a newspaper, you know, chit chatting with someone, asking someone an address, or telling the cab driver that, you know, go and drop me at this location. Okay. Everything is OSINT. We are doing OSINT in our day-to-day lives. We are reading newspaper. We are gathering open source information. We are chit-chatting to someone. We are gathering some information. We are telling someone, we are asking someone directions. We are gathering information, right? Everything is OSINT, open source information. In terms of cyber world, OSINT is, you know, all the information that is available on the surface level. Okay, that is already available, which is easily accessible and available for everyone. Okay, so it's not something which is restrictive. It's not something that is personal identifier. Okay, it is something which is open and public, and anyone can access it. That is open source information. Right now, number one, OSINT, very biggest factor, like the why PI love it is, you know, the fact that it doesn't have any, you know, legalities involved. Right, you're doing tons and tons of OSINT on a single profile. Like, you know, by doing the OSINT, you entirely, you can find a, you know, entire bio data and everything you just, you know, pile up using OSINT. Still, you know, no one has the right to subject you, or, you know, no one has the right to object, I mean, that what is this? Why? Because whatever information you have collected, it is already publicly available. So what is known, you know, there is no legal crisis at all. No legal crisis at all. Okay. Biggest advantage of OSINT. Okay. And trust me, if I say about the demand of OSINT, whether it comes to corporate, OSINT is very important. It is, you know, given respect. Whether it comes to a personal level as a PI, I already said people do love OSINT. Okay. Whether it comes to some private investigation agency, maximum of the information and recon is done on OSINT basis. Whether it comes to police department, you go and check up on, you know, various state polices such as Kerala Police, Maharashtra Cyber. They want people to work on OSINT. You know, every year Kerala Police, even, you know, they come up with 2 or 3 hackathons dedicated to OSINT. Okay. I mean, you know the worth of OSINT now, right? And we'll be discussing a lot of OSINT stuff. This will be the start of it today. Okay. Now, for some of the, you can say, aspects or some of the practicals that we'll be requiring, not all, but some of them, we'll be requiring a Linux system. Okay, I'm making it very clear as of from now only, although it is, you know, 1 or 2 days even more, I guess. But we will be requiring a Linux system. So make sure you have a Linux system, whether you use Ubuntu, whether you use Kali Linux, up to your choice. Okay, but make sure you have a Linux system ready. You can choose it in VirtualBox. Now, basically, you all might be aware that there are 3 types of information gathering techniques. Number one is active, passive. Mainly, if you have any, ask anyone, most of the people are aware of the 2, active and passive. But when it comes to open source information, and when it comes to a broader perspective, then there is 3rd category, which is known as semi-passive also. Okay. Now, basically, there's something missing in this documentation for sure, 100%. Okay. Just give me a minute, okay? Just a minute. There is something that is not there inside the document. I'll just, you know, fetch out the new version. Okay, anyways, you know, ignore it. I'm not finding. Yeah, share the screen once again. Hope it's visible. So there are 3 types of information gathering techniques: active, passive, and 3rd one, you can just kindly call it as semi-passive. Active means you are collecting information directly from the target. So there is direct interaction of the target. The target is directly involved. Okay. It is a highly dangerous technique. Basically, why? Because the target can be alerted, and you know there could be legalities imposed on you and all those other things. But the information what you are fetching from active is accurate. Passive, it's less accurate, but it's very stealthy. It's very stealthy. The methods through which information is obtained without any involvement of target, where a target is not at all considered in the entire recon process, right? So this is where OSINT lies into passive recon. Okay, because whatever information you are collecting, it is without involvement of target. It is already publicly available, right? So for example, if you're stalking someone's Instagram profile and fetching information from there, what it is, you're not involving target directly. Are you messaging? No, you're not messaging. What you are doing is whatever information that is already present on the LinkedIn or Instagram profile, you are just fetching that. That information, anyone can fetch, anyone sitting in the world. That is what passive recon. And the specific, like the main OSINT category lies in passive. And there is something called a semi-passive now. Semi-passive is nothing. It's kind of, a choice. It's kind of a process that is between active and semi-passive, where the information is indirectly obtained from the target, but target is not the direct source. Okay. Now, for example, I'm not giving any technical example as of now. Technical example, I won't say it verbally. Technical examples, we'll see it practically. But giving you a non-technical layman example for semi-passive, you can just say that I'm taking names. So for example, I am there. Okay. We have Ayush sir. Okay. And we have, Urvesh. After we have Ayush sir and we have Urvesh. How does semi-passive technique will work? So Urvesh is a person whom I want to target and fetch information. Okay. So I want to collect information about Urvesh, but I don't want to follow active recon. Now, I know one simple thing, that Ayush sir knows Urvesh very well. Okay. They are in touch. Okay. And Ayush sir knows me also. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use Ayush sir as a jack. Okay, as a jack. And I'm going to, fetch out information about Urvesh from Ayush sir indirectly. Right? So that is somewhat will land up into semi-passive. Okay. And we'll see the technical examples also. So, that is semi-passive technique. Indirectly. So someone else on your behalf is getting the information from the target. So it could be something that, I'm like telling, okay, Ayush sir, tell me one thing, what exactly does Urvesh is teaching? So Ayush sir is like, I don't know. Let me just, ask him. I'm like, yeah, go and ask him. So, Ayush sir is a mediator for me, who is getting information directly from the target and giving it to me. But I am not directly in touch with the target. That is semi-passive, somewhere between active and passive. Okay. Now, there are a few things that are not present in this document, and I'll just add them into tomorrow's class. Okay, that are important, we'll see. But something is known as identifiers in OSINT. Okay, you are always supposed to look out for these kind of identifiers. Okay, anyone who can give me examples of identifiers in the chat box? Identifiers are nothing but they are certain attributes associated with a person or a target through which we can get some information. I said the technical definition. Now, any one of you can give me some examples of identifiers or personal identifiers? Okay. No one? Name, age, exactly, right? Now, what we could do is, I have a photo. These are some of the examples of identifiers. We have name, okay, email, birthday, IP addresses, MAC addresses, phone numbers, home address we have. Then we have, you can say, license plate, time frame, picture, Bitcoin, password hash, OS information, social media, relationship, occupation, username, hobbies, credit card, hacker handles, you know, websites. These are some of the examples of identifiers. Okay. Okay. Now, over here, just a minute. I am audible, I guess. Now, what we are going to do move on further is, as of, you know, there is the things that I wanted to tell a bit about OSINT has not been present. It's kind of the OSINT process and the methodology. But the point is, let's ignore that. We'll see it in tomorrow's class. Okay. Now, what we are going to do today in form of an starting of the OSINT is, we are going to look at web OSINT. Okay. Now, what does web OSINT mean? Web OSINT simply means collecting info from the web. Okay. Collecting info from the web websites. Now, there are a few methods for today. You know, we'll discuss web request tools. Right. Now, there are a few. I mean, this is not the only thing that is there for website recon. This is the initial class for starting of the OSINT. We have a lot more to cover. We have a lot more to add. This is just for today's class that I've created this document. So whatever the tools that we'll be using in today's class, and we'll stop. And we will continue with more tools and other processes of OSINT in the upcoming classes, right? So just don't assume that this is only for web recon that much. It's not limited at all. Now, a few tools to discuss upon practicals. So the first technical information, or you can say, one of the most important technical information that you need to gather about a website is web technologies used. What are the web technologies used? Such as, what are the advertisement systems? What is the web and the email hosting provider? What are the scripts that are being used? What are the JavaScript libraries? What programming languages are used to build the website? For that, you could be very much aware of this. There are two famous, very famous tools known as builtwith.com and vapalizer.com. And one thing I'll make very clear is, throughout the entire OSINT module, there will be a lot of tools that we are going to do, you know, that are already online. We don't need any special operating system or something downloading or something of them. A lot of tools will be online. At the same time, a few tools will be in Linux also. Okay. So that is how we are going to proceed with. So these are whatever tools that we are using in today's class and in a few of the upcoming classes, they all will be online tools. Okay. No need to some download special things and all, right? So the first website is built with. Let me just open this website. Okay. Just give me a minute. Just give me a minute. Okay. Yeah. Sorry, folks, for making you hold once again, but I was receiving an, you can say, really unavoidable call. So I just had to mute myself and pick up that. Right. Now, what you know, this particular tools will help you to analyze this. This particular tools will actually help us to analyze that on what technologies the website are built. So whichever website, you know, you scan through them, it will just tell you the list of technologies and the scripts and everything that have been, you know, used. For example, if I just choose the Hacktivists or, okay, just say any random website. Let me just think of any website. Let me just choose my own website, dummy website it is. Okay, thegeekboy.net. Okay, now if I just, you know, look up over here, within seconds it just, you know, provided me the entire things. So what are the widgets used? Google Tag Manager and Wix Pro Gallery. Now, by understanding Wix Pro Gallery, what can you conclude? That the website is developed using Wix, correct? Then while you can say Viewport Meta and Apple Mobile Web Eclipse Icon, these are something used. CMS, Content Management System, it's Wix, and it's Wix Premium. Okay, so Wix Premium is, it's Wix, and moreover, it is telling you that this particular website does Wix Premium plan. Okay, so it's ad free. Then JavaScript libraries, Webpack, RequireJS, CoreJS, Sentry, Roadstar, Zepto, advertising, these are Google AdSense and DoubleClick.net. Are used for advertising. For SSL by default, and Let's Encrypt, these are the SSL technologies. Web hosting providers, Google and Google Cloud. Name server, again Wix. Email providers, Google Apps for Business. Robots.txt, you know, you can view more information about it. Now, if I go up, is, and I can just detailed technology profile. It will give me all the detailed technological profile of this particular website that I've scanned over here. Right. For example, there is right click protect for Wix. If I click over, see that it is avoiding right click. Over. Right clicks are not allowed on Wix. So this is a particular widget, or you can say a technological point that is used in this particular website. Okay. Similarly, you can go and see up for other things also. Then metadata profile. Nothing has been fetched because it's a kind of not a famous domain. So this is relationship profile, okay, and this is something you can see what it is. Can anyone say me in the chat box? What exactly it is? What do you think it is? This is nothing but Google AdSense Analytics ID. Correct. This is the Google AdSense Analytics ID. Then redirect profile. If there are any redirections, so there is no redirections, right? So built with is one of the most amazing and my own personal favorite. You can even add as an extension to Chrome. And also one important fact, you can get a notification whenever, you know, there are some new technologies added to this website. You can create a notification for that. It will, you know, notify you. Similar to this, there is second app known as Wappalizer. This is again also frequently used by everyone, especially into bug bounty and all. It is used a lot, Wappalizer. Over here also, if I just type thegeekboy.net. So probably this website, okay, HTTPS, if I just type. So I need to just sign up. But what you could do is you can even use this website built with this kind of a more elaborated version when it compares to Wappalizer. But what generally people do is they add the Wappalizer extension over there. And whenever you go on a website, you click on Wappalizer and it will show you the details. But I believe the built with is kind of a more detailed information. And I mean, it's my personal opinion. You can just give a try to Wappalizer also, right? But personally, I have been using built with more often than Wappalizer. Okay, the next part of information that, you know, we can focus to create on is the Google ID. I just said Google Analytics ID, right? almost, you know, you can say the giants, that not the giants, but almost you can say everyone hosting on the website, many a times it's possible that they have a Google Analytics ID, right? Many a times. What happens is, what you could, via OSINT, what you can analyze, that using this analytics ID is, you know, unique. Okay. So what you could analyze, sometimes a business may have one or more than one website. OSINT can help us to discover multiple websites owned by a particular company. Google Analytics, which is a service for measuring your advertising ROI, can be utilized to get in the following steps. Now, for example, it can be used in terms of competition also. So someone is using the same analytics ID, right? Or the company is using one analytics ID for all the other websites. We can track it. How? We have to use this tool, which is known as reverse analytics ID. Okay. And this particular tool is, again, an online tool. You have to just, you know, add up the domain name or the analytical ID. So if I just add analytics ID, if I add a domain name. So if you know, no valid analytics ID found, please try your, okay, so I don't know why. What I'll do is, I have this analytics ID with me. You can just copy and paste it over here. I'll do this way. Yeah. So see, on this particular website, there is, you can say, no analytics ID found for the geekboy.net for any other existing domain on the same ID. Right? That is what it is just trying to say us. If there are any, it will fetch you the results. Okay. Now, this is something which you are also quite familiar, but as you know, this is a base, you know, we are building a kind of interest towards OSINT. So all the tools are, you know, kind of very much familiar tools that you could already know. This analyze historical information is something which is known as Wayback Machine, right? Wherein what you could do is, you can just see what are the previous changes made in the website. So this is the Wayback Machine over here. You can see what were the previous versions. So whatever changes that were done in the website, you can see using the Wayback Machine over here right now. Okay. For example, I'm again using that URL, the geekboy.net. See, it will fetch some timestamps for me. So 2013, 20 and 21 directly. 20 after 13, 2020 directly. Now, if I go in 2020, and you can see there are some highlighted things over here, which are known as snapshots. So what does it mean that on March 10, 2020, there was some change made on the website. I can click an open link in a new tab, and in 2021, I can go. So there is no, on Jan 12, there is a snapshot and open link in a new tab. It will exactly load the page as it was on March, 10, exactly how the website was looking at that time and how the website is looking on, was looking on Jan 12. So what was the change exactly? So for example, on March 10, 2020, the website was something like this. Okay. And in the month of 2021, the website is something like this now. Okay. I mean, it's still loading. It takes time to load, right? It takes some time to load. So you can easily see the theme or something has been changed completely. You can even, navigate the website as it was during that time. Then there is something in 2013, it doesn't. So what exactly it meant? See, to be honest, I registered the domain, this particular domain I registered in 2020. How come in 2013 it is showing me? The fact is, in 2013, someone was owning this domain. And thereafter, that person thought, okay, I don't want this domain anymore. Back in then 2020, I thought, okay, no, this domain I want now, right? So, you can say, it's, you know, fetching the data. So in 2013, someone else was, you know, having this domain, the geekboy.net, right? So this way you can, you know, you can dig down into the historical data. See, something else is coming up. The website that was there in 2013 at that time. It's some other language, right? Someone thought, I don't want this after 2013. And then all of a sudden in the world, I thought I want it now. So it was how it, you know, fetched up the results. Correct. Okay. Now going further, who is information? This is something, I mean, very common, and I expect everyone to know already, right? I mean, as I said, this is an introductory class, and we are just, you know, digging down slowly into OSINT, right? So there will be some concepts which you already know. Now, who is the widely ranged use internet record listing that identifies who owns a domain and how to get them in contact with. So the Internet Corporation for Assigned Names, the ICASNN, regulates the domain name registration and the ownership. Whois records have proven to be extremely useful and developed into an essential resource for maintaining the integrity of the domain name and the registrations and the website ownership process completely. Right? Now over here, typically each website whose record will contain information such as name and contact information of the registrants, who owns the domain, the name and the contact information of the registrar. The registrar, who is the registrar, he's the registrar is nothing but the organization, that is the, you can say the hosting provider is nothing but registrar. Okay, the registration date, the server name, it all, you know, this all kind of information will be provided in Whois. There are millions and trillions of tools available online, you know, to fetch out Whois. One of the most uses, whois.net. Here I can just type the geekboy.net. I don't know why it's okay. I'll just wish Whois. Oops, sorry, I just misspelled that. This is what, you know, Whois information. I mean, this is something that's a domain provider. Let us not go into this. Let us, okay, just tell the Whois from here only. It's unavailable because it is already registered, right? Yeah, this is the Whois information. The domain information, the contact information, and all those other things. Now, I don't have any Whois protection on the website, so my information could be easily available over here, right? But many of the websites, they do have a Whois protection layer added, right? For example, activist.in. You can see it gets registered on GoDaddy. Where does it register? On ExpireZone. So all that information. Now over here, see the actual person who registered the domain, that information is hidden because Whois protection has been added. Correct? This is how you can fetch into the Whois information. Now there is a tool which is known as a unified OSINT tools known as SynapseInt. Okay. This tool is there, SynapseInt online. Okay. Wherein you can get, you can, there are other options also. It's not that active, but you can get a lot of information about domain. For example, the geekboy.net. So yeah, https://. Now it takes some time. It takes 2 to 3 minutes to fetch up the results. But again, it contains, you know, you can say this tool, this website, what it has, you know, all in one. It is an all in one tool. You can just say not not exactly all in one, but most of the things that you're looking at, you can find on using the single tool itself. Right? This is how these tools will work. So here it's fetching some of the results. Yeah, see, here I have the server IP and meta-analysis, virus total analysis, Wayback Machine records, screenshots, there are no screenshots as of now, network, wix.com, ports, blacklisted, so whether its website is good or not, subdomains, there is no subdomain, same IP domains. What do you mean by same IP domains? So it's a shared server, correct? It's a shared server, basically. It means that multiple websites are hosted on the same server. So these are the associated other domains that are there. So I don't think any of them, they could be up. There is something StudyStream, which is hosted on the same IP as on my website. Cool. I realized it right away. It was not there a few months ago or something. Wow. Location, it will tell you, I mean, the server is registered. So it's US, obviously. Who is information, you can find all in one over here. Then DNS lookup you can do. So this DNS lookup, this is known as a domain name server lookup, where you can find the different kind of records that are present on website. So MX records, here it is there. For NS records, it's there. A and AAA SOA records, TXT records, you can find in web tech. Technology is used. So over here, it doesn't show as detailed as built with, but a kind of a single that it's using Wix. Paste. So is there any website copies or paste available in Pastebin or something like that, other sources and links? So there is no particular link that has been, you know, present associated external links or social internal links or something like that, right? It's kind of, and you can say, a partial AIO tool, all in one tool, correct? Where you can find all the information at a single paste, right? I'll just, you know, copy this, go into MS Teams, Wiki, oops, sorry, not over here, in Wiki, here it is, okay. I mean, the documentation also will be given. Now, another important OSINT perspective that we are looking at in terms of website is analyzing the similar domains. Okay, what do you mean by this, analyzing similar domains? Let us go and directly check it. Now, see what sort of trouble users can get into type of typing in a domain name. Find look-alike domains. Look-alike domains. You know, remember the term look-alike domains, and practically we will see what does it mean. So, for example, there is the geekboy.net. It's known as the anti-phishing domain name search engine also. And it's doing something tuck, 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 and 78, 79, 100. So what exactly it will do is, it will tell us the similar kind of domain. So for example, if there is the geekboy.net, there is geekbox.net, you know, or there is the.geekboy.net, the.geekboy.net. It could be a domain, it could be a fake domain, or it could be an impersonating domain for me. It is redirecting to somewhere. Now it's not there. So we can just look up the who is history of this then. And there is something the geekboy.net. This is. This is the main original website. Right, and there is something called as the geekbox.net. How many are available? These many are available. All right. Similarly, if you see the hacktivists.in, So there are two, basically, the.hacktivist.in and the.hacktivist.in. Basically, the.hacktivist.in, you can say, is nothing, but there is no MX record. It kind of, you can say, a kind of a typo that it is always doing to present, but it is, I don't think so, it is registered at all. Right? So, go to web address. Yeah, I just said it won't be there. So the hacktivist.in is there, but it's again kind of not properly registered. And then there is the main, the hacktivist.in. This is the main site that will be there. Yeah, right? And this is how it will look upon. And these many are available. For example, these many are the options. So www.thehacktivist.in. Right. See, these are homoglyphs. Homoglyphs means exactly look alike. XSN, and you can see these are nothing but these are homoglyphs, which anyone can use to impersonate. So see, thehacktivist.in, thehacktivist.in, which are impersonating domains basically. Thehacktivist.in, right? And the last perspective for today that we are going to see is a semi-passive OSINT tool online, which is known as urlscan.io. Okay. Now, what does this urlscan.io does? It is a service which analyzes the websites and the resources they request. Much like the inspector of your browser, right? So, for example, when you visit a website directly, you have multiple requests going on, right? So, instead of directly visiting the website, the urlscan.io, it will visit the website on your behalf and tell you what requests have been made. Okay. So if I do URL scan, so you don't have to directly make a request on that. Otherwise your IP or something maybe get logged. So in order to avoid that, you can use urlscan.io in order to make request. So see, this is called a semi-passive. You want to collect information about the geekbird.net, but you are not going directly. Urlscan.io is something or someone making request on your behalf and fetching information from you. Right. So it will, you know, load us some results over here. Can you see this? The snapshot, the live screenshot. You can just see the live screenshots. Correct. Then we can see all the other information, IP, ASNs, IP detail, the domains that are associated, the domain tree, the links. There are some links present in the website. There are some certs, frames, iframes or something. So this particular page makes 112 requests. 90% of them are HTTPS, right? This is how it actually, you know, fetches the results. Then you can see the request exactly, the redirects if there are any, links if there are any, behavior of it, indicators, similar. Correct. So this is something called as semi-passive then. Okay, so that is all for today's class. Basically, now we will dig down into OSINT more and more. As I said, OSINT is one of the biggest chapter in the course and one of the most amazing one. Okay. Now, one update before leaving. Okay, so today is 8th Friday. Tomorrow is 9th. Okay. And we are expecting to wind up the course. By 15th or 16th, the max. Okay. That is when we are planning to, then, you know, winding up the entire course. Okay. One update I just wanted to give you off. And keep your Linux system ready for the upcoming OSINT classes. So any doubts so far? Yeah, so this xn dot dot dot, they are puny codes, exactly. Homoglyph URLs. I mean, there are more dangerous homoglyphs which are exactly identical once you register them. So anyone any doubts? So real case studies, I think we will have in the last module for missing person, no evidence case and all. Apart from that, if you remember the previous case study of murder, like two murders and all, there will be, I think, a few more like that. You need to just confirm once, right? So that we are going to have probably in the last module. Okay. So then let's just, you know, wind up the class for today. Thanks for joining, and we'll continue deep diving into OSINT the upcoming further classes. Okay. Have a good night, everyone.